Let's rise as we're able tonight. Everybody take a deep breath in. Then let out all of your energy and frustration of the day and leave it in the hands of God just from the get-go. Come on, let's do it. Let's sing that together now. Thank you tonight that you are the risen Lord. Death could not hold you down. In the same way that death cannot hold you down, death cannot hold us down today. Because you left us with a promise that greater works than these shall we do. Greater works than what Jesus did coming off of that cross, out of that tomb. We have an opportunity every day to come out of our own burials. And I ask you to raise us back to life once again tonight into your holy presence as we proclaim that we see you move mountains. And we know, God, that you can do it once again. Is that anybody's testimony tonight? Now this is my favorite part of the song, where we get to boldly declare that the same way God moved mountains once before, we're going to see God do that again in our own lives.
I see you move. I see you move. You move the mountains. God moved a mountain for you. I see you do it again.
Still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Sing it out. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Clap of nothing good in me. You are love on display for all to see. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sins. Sing it with me.
You are peace when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting.
So let's sing this together in unison.
And no. Thy becomes to your hand praise.
heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus. Sometimes we come back into church after taking a little break, or we've never been in a church setting before at all, and these words seem a little weird, because I hear the words, my heart will sing no other name, and I think, well, what if I want to sing my boyfriend's name, or my husband's name, or my girlfriend's name, or what if I don't even believe in Jesus and I want to sing a different name? And I'm going to go out on a little bit of a limb here and say that that is okay. That this is a place that where you can sing whatever name you feel comfortable singing. And the reason for me that it means so much to be able to walk into these doors and actually sing the name of Jesus, that name that I fell in love with as a 7 or 8 year old child, that name that never quite was ripped from me when everything else was, that name that had a chance to be used against me in abusive power struggle situations, never quite left my heart. And so whenever I might have hopped away from Jesus and sang to another name that left me hanging, I could always go back to the name of Jesus. And so I challenge you tonight to reclaim the name of Jesus for your life. Because when mountains shift and things move, there's a name that for me is above every other name. And I sing it as a love song to a God that never left me. I sing it as a love song to a foundation that was stable even when I wasn't. So I challenge you, if you feel the need to sing these words, or if you feel like you can, let's sing it together. My heart will sing no other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing no other name.
The world. God is good all the time, all the time. God is good. Indeed, God is good. And as Chris said, no matter what name you pray to, no matter what ways you reach out to and connect with the divine, know that in this place, it is all welcome here. No matter who you are and what faith journey brought you into this place, we are glad that you are here, your whole self. If you're worshiping with us for the first time, we are so glad you made it in tonight. And we would love to spend a little time after the service getting to know you. So please stop by the Connect Center in the back, the info bar, and chat with us a little bit about what brought you in here tonight. My friends, this is a time in our service when we take 2 minutes to greet one another with the peace of Christ, with the ways in which the God in me meets the God in you. So why don't we stand and greet one another for 2 minutes?
Just having far too much fun out there. You're a great group tonight. We're so glad that you are present with us, and we're preparing for the word that will be brought to us in just a few moments from Reverend Andre, who I know has a wonderful word for us tonight. But it says we prepare to receive the word, to hear the word, to find the word that speaks to us this night. We want to remind you of some of the upcoming events that are happening in our church, and so if you would take your worship bulletin, you will get to see some of those. First of all, I want to remind you, this coming Friday, we are on our second annual bowl-a-thon. I'm excited about it. I'm just so excited. I think we have nearly 200 folks from the congregation already signed up to go to bowling on Friday night, so there's still room, so please do sign up this evening. It really does help us to make sure that we know who's coming. Now, if, of course, like some of us, you leave everything to the last minute, just in case you get a better deal on Friday evening. There's no better deal than bowling with us on Friday evening. But just in case you're one of those people, you can actually just come to the door and sign up. We'd rather that you signed up before so that you know and we know who to expect on Friday evening. It's going to be great fun. There's going to be raffles. There's going to be auctions. They're going to auction me off for one game of bowling. That's all you get from me. And it really is a wonderful, wonderful evening. So please do join us on Friday evening. That's 6 o'clock for registration, 7 o'clock. We do some practice bowling, and at 7:15, the lanes will open, and we have nearly 2 hours of bowling. So please do join us on Friday evening. You can see the information there on your bulletin. Also want to remind you that we want to hear from you. It's important for us that we get to hear from you about your prayer concerns, but also about things that you need from us. Here at Cathedral of Hope, we believe in responsive ministry. What that means is that the clergy are not mind readers. And so we want to meet your expectations. So please do let us know if there are things that you need from us as your clergy, as your ministers, in the ways that we can care for one another. So please do do check that out. Also check out all the other things that are happening. You can also keep up to date on Facebook and on our website. And talking about Facebook, who's got a smartphone on them this evening? Then why don't you just take it out for a moment? Why don't you just go to Facebook? Why don't you just check in at Pulse this evening so that all of your friends know that that's exactly where you are? If you've already done it, good on you. If you haven't, please do so, because it's important that people know about our relationship with God and about where we are in our own spiritual journey. So please do check in this evening. Also, we're about to receive our offering, and so please prepare to do that. If you are with us for the very first time this evening and you did not prepare to come to give, please do not feel obligated to give. We are glad that you are here. You are our guest. If, of course, you did prepare to give, the offering baskets will come around in just a few moments. And please do take the red information pads at the end of each pew and pass them along so that we can remain connected with you. Those of you who are regular here at the church will know that we are planning our next Sunday morning chapel service at 10 o'clock on Sunday, the 6th of May, if I'm correct. That will be in the Interfaith Peace Chapel. That's the second preview service in preparation for a regular Sunday morning 10 o'clock worship service, which will be in a more contemporary style. It's the way in which we are broadening the ways in which we do worship here at Cathedral of Hope. Not one worship is more important than the other, but we do want to make sure that we open pathways for folks to access their own spirituality in the way that most fits them. So we're very excited about that, and so want you to make sure that you know about that preview service. Also this evening, we have Pulse Cafe, and so directly after worship, don't feel as if you have to run right out the door, but do stick around. There are some cupcakes and some goodies at the back there, but we're going to be fed by spiritual food, we're going to have some real food, and then we're going to have some fellowship food in the way that we connect with one another. So as has already been said this evening, God is good. All the time, God is good. And so we want to celebrate that goodness that is in God, knowing that God is also in you. So allow that goodness that has been fostered in us through our worship, through our praise, and through this act of worship by the giving of our tithes and our talents and our gifts to be made real in this place. Let's pray together as we ask God's blessing on this offering. God, we are so thankful for your presence in our lives and for the Spirit that is freely running in this place. We are grateful, God, that you are a God who calls us beyond ourselves to meet with a higher power, to meet with the one that we call God. And so it is in that we respond to you, God. We respond through service. We respond through the giving of our time and our talent and our tithes. We respond, God, because we know that you have good news that has been given to us and good news that we want to share. We respond to you this evening in so many different ways, by the raising of our hands and by the singing of our voices and by the response to the word that is about to be preached for us this night. And so in all these things, we declare you good as you declare us good, worthy and whole and made in your divine image. Now bless this offering, that it might be given from a place of generosity, from a place of joy, from a place of giving, that it might be enough. No, that it would be more than enough for what you have called this church to do and called this church to be. And so it is, in the name of the one that we call Jesus, our Christ. Amen.
So some of y'all might recognize that familiar tune that Shauna's playing right now. Some of y'all might not, because I probably wouldn't have a name. But We're going to sing a song called Man in the Mirror. It's going to be sung with some non-men folk as well. And so no matter if you look at a woman in the mirror or a man in the mirror, or you label yourself as something different, you can sing along with us however you like. And the only reason we didn't change it from man is because it would have thrown the beat off. But now we owe you a girl song, so we're gonna sing some Beyonce Who Run the World in a couple of weeks.
I'm gonna make a change for once in my life. It's gonna feel real good. I'm gonna make a difference. I'm gonna make it right. As I turn up the collar on my favorite winter coat, this wind is blowing my mind.
I see the kids in the street without enough to eat. Who am I to be blind, pretending not to see their need?
A summer disregard, a broken bottle top, and a one-man show. They follow each other on the wind, you know, 'cause they got
my goodness. Wasn't that good? Yeah. Y'all, I had church. I thought I was about to have a Holy Ghost hop there in a minute. That was really, what a blessing. Thank y'all. That was just great. We really are blessed. Why does this thing not? Never mind. Never mind. It is good to see you tonight. I am so glad that you're here. And if this is your first time again, welcome. Last week, you know, I feel a little overdressed. Last week, Chris led the worship in shorts. And if you're from my tradition, he would have sat down. They would sit him down for 3 weeks. He wouldn't get to do worship. And Reverend Michael preached in a T-shirt that we have over there, and we encourage you to get them. So I think I'm just going to settle down and take off my jacket. Careful. Careful, Reverend Aaron. That's Hugo Boss. I want to encourage you to... isn't he a blessing? I want to encourage you to come on May the 6th to the chapel. It is an amazing experience. Now, if you come to 9/11, that's great. You stay here. But if this kind of worship is what really speaks to your heart, I hope that you will come, because it was just incredible the last two times we've been there, Sunday and then when we did the pre-service on a Wednesday. So I hope that you will come to that and be a part of that great service. Y'all, it was our pastor's birthday on Monday and 3-year anniversary. Would you give him a hand clap of love? I tell you, God knew what God was doing when God brought him our way. Ain't that the truth? What a blessing. We're so fortunate, and I am grateful that I get to call him my pastor and my friend. Now, tonight, we're in a series. If you were wondering why we were singing that secular song in the house of God, I just had to dig that in. I can't hide my roots. I try to hide my roots, but we're still going to make Chris Chisholm sit down for those shorts he wore. I mean, never mind. So, but anyway, if you were wondering why we're singing that, we're in the middle of a series entitled Playlist, and this is a song that I just love. It's on my list of songs that I listen to. I'm like Oprah. I don't listen to music in the car. Oprah doesn't listen to music in the car, and I don't either. But when I do listen to music, like on an airplane, this is on my list. So, and it's all about today's message. So would you stand for the reading? Jeremiah 29, verse 13. Jeremiah 29, verse 13, and it reads like this. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. Say amen for the reading.
Amen.
Turn to your neighbor, look them in the eye. Say neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, you can do it a little louder. Say neighbor.
Neighbor.
This one's for you.
This one's for you.
Make a change.
Make a change.
All right, have a seat if you can. Every time we hear the word grace, we ought to smile. Every time you hear grace mentioned, we ought to see every tooth in your mouth that you were born with or have left. Let's practice that right now. Grace.
Grace.
All right, some of y'all ain't smiling. We'll do it again. Second time. Let's try second time. One more time. Grace.
Grace.
One more time. Third time's a charm. Everybody ought to get it by now. You be on board. One more time. Grace.
Grace.
Just to hear the word grace ought to make joy bells ring down in your soul. Now, for some of you, I know some of you think grace is the grace period you get when your bills are behind. It's due on the 1st, but if you do it by the 15th, after the 15th, it's late, so you have till the 15th, so that's the grace period from the 1st to the 15th. But I submit to you, grace is so much more. We cannot detach grace from who God is. Reverend Neil, Dr. Jonas was an influential professor I had in my life. He believed we have a God with all power, but a people that are weak and frail and tight. So his belief was interesting, that we are a people who are connected to God, but because we are satisfied with where we are, content with what we've got, we're happy with heading nowhere. He said that when people look at church, they ought to see God. Yet we see saints that are satisfied and stuck in a rut. He said the problem is with the modern day church is that it's happy with ordinary. He said, we are happy being ordinary, stuck being ordinary. We want ordinary. We don't want anything more than ordinary. We're just happy with everything being ordinary. But the truth is, God is extraordinary and wants his children to function like he functions. Yes, God does use ordinary people. You don't have to have a PhD for God to use you. You don't have to be wealthy for God to use you. God can use anybody to help somebody through an ordinary life. However, if you are connected to God, you may think you are ordinary. But when you are connected to God, you will become extraordinary. You're supposed to move mountains. You're supposed to lift valleys. You're supposed to walk on water. You're supposed to do the unthinkable, accomplish the incredible. The problem with us is we are so stuck with being ordinary that we've missed extraordinary. There comes a time when you are tired of ordinary. You want more in your life. And you look at God and you say, I think it's time to make a change. I want more. Reverend Aaron, the new year is behind us, and some of us are already repeating the same things that we did last year. There ought to come a time in your journey when you say, hold on, God. It's time for me to make a change. If you're still hanging around the same sorry people, doing the same stuff, going the same direction, hear this. It's time to make a change. I'm going to get myself up in a sweat in a minute. If you still have the same income with the same job that you had last year, that you hated last year, and you still hate it this year, I've got news for you. It's time to make a change. If you're spiritually stuck in a rut and want more from God than you that you've ever had in your life, then you're not going to get it by doing what you've always done. It's time for a new level of praying, a new level of trusting. I need some people who are thirsty for more of God. I want to talk to people tonight that say, hold on, I feel like I'm designed for more. I'm designed for greater. The reason God keeps waking me up every day is because I haven't lived my best days yet. I haven't had my best week. I haven't had my best month. I haven't accomplished what God has for me. I think that what God has for me is blessed and favored, and it's time for me to make a change. Listen, and let me caution you. When you decide you're going to make a change, there are some people who are not going to like you anymore. Let me go on and tell you the real secret. They didn't like you before you made your change. You just thought they did. There are some people who are going to be jealous of you as soon as you decide, I ain't hanging out with you anymore. But listen to me, they were jealous of you before you decided. That's why they couldn't celebrate with you every time God blesses you. There are some people who are envious of you. Let me go on and tell you, they were not your friend to begin with. There are some people who are going to be upset with you because they benefit from you when you are in bondage. But today I declare freedom over your life and into your faith. I declare freedom in your finances, freedom in your heart, freedom in your relationships. God has already set for you more than you could ever imagine. It was an experience. It doesn't define you. Stop letting bad experiences define you. Carrying bad experiences or the way you used to think about yourself from the past around you. Too many times we carry stuff that happened so long ago and we still keep it with us. We still talk about it. I heard somebody say the other day, 7 years ago, this happened to me. I thought, seven? What? You're still talking about something that happened 7 years ago? And the person went, yeah, but I got so hurt. I said, but 7 years? What are you doing? Are you 7 years? Time for us to let it go. You ought not to be talking about things that happened 7 years ago. It was an experience. It doesn't define you. The bad stuff. It doesn't define you. We carry it with us. If we carry it in our lives and we talk about it like it happened this morning. Honey, it happened years ago. It happened months ago. It might have happened weeks ago. Let it go. It doesn't define you. It does not define you. It was an experience. Might have been a bad experience, but it was an experience. God can take a person from a messed up past, from a messed up place, and set them up on a rock where they can bless everyone else. What's your point, Dr. Dre? It's not where you are from that counts. I don't care if you're broke, poor, messed up, crackhead, whether you danced as a stripper on a pole, danced, smoked weed, went to the swing out club, got high, used drugs every day. I don't care. The good news is you serve a God who will take you from that and put you on a whole other track. Hey, I'm about to preach myself happy. In order to get what God has for you, sometimes you have to leave where you are to go where you're meant to be. God says, I'm not going to bless you so that you can be stuck up, snobby, bougie, uppery, half-cocked and half-crazy. I'm blessing you so you can bless somebody else. The reason God wants to bless you is so you can bless others. Anybody want more from God tonight? I want deeper worship with God, a deeper relationship with God. And in order to get it, I have to make a change. I got to leave some stuff, cut some stuff off, because I'm making a change. I've had enough of where I am, and I want to go where God wants me to go in my life. If you're going to get what God has for you, there must be a departure from what was into what is about to become. If you want what God, this is good. You want to write all of this down. Just get the CD. I've ordered CDs for myself. If you want what God wants, if you want what God wants, you have to change some stuff that you have been doing, because what you're doing right now will only get you what you already have. God may want you to leave some people around you, friends you like to hang out with, because all of y'all are in the same boat. If I'm broke and you broke, we ain't ever going to have anything. If I'm dumb and you're dumb, somebody's got to help us. If you're crazy and I'm crazy, we're just a crazy group. At some point, you got to say, I'm tired of all of that and I want something better. I hope you're getting it, because I'm going around and around on the same thing. I was raised driving a shift car. Anybody remember shift car? Shift car is where you have it's a standard car. You got three pedals and a stick in the floor. My niece got my car, bless her heart. She didn't know how to drive it. See, in an automatic car, you just put your foot on the gas, mash it, and off you go. But in a standard, you got to do the gears. If you don't change the gears, you're going to mess it up. You're going to kill the engine. So I'm with my niece, and I'm teaching her how to drive this car, and she had a bad habit of leaving it in the same gear. So it would sound like, and I'm like, girl, change it. So we got into this rhythm where it would go, and I go, change it, change it, change it. Listen, some of you have been in the same gear for far too long. God is saying, change it. Change the way you think. Change the way you live. Change who you hang out with. Change it. If you're tired of your outcome, change it. If you're tired of crying, change it. If you're tired of struggling, change it. If you're tired of being broke, stop it. If you're tired of sick and tired of everything, change it. Change is inevitable. But progress is optional. Just because you change doesn't mean you will make progress. Progress is planned. It's premeditated. You set a goal for that. You work for that. You can't come into church, do three shouts, do a James Brown split, and say, look what I got. The reason why all of us are not shouting and running laps is because we don't understand the right now and the not yet. See, we think that right now is what we will always have. But the truth is, God is saying, if you could see your not yet, you would shout about your right now. Yeah. That's deep. Somebody ought to shout. Because your right now and your not yet don't look the same. If you could see your not yet, you would shout like you've never shouted before, because you are going to move some mountains. God's going to open some doors. God's going to give some increase. God's going to put some people under your feet. Oh, thank you, Jesus. God's going to erase your past. If you could see what God has planned for you, you would celebrate in this house right now, because it requires making a change. Hard to believe, but I went fishing about 7 years ago now. It was a boat like Sister Donna has. I ain't never been on her boat because she ain't never invited me. They're not here tonight, so I can show some. I can throw some shade. But listen, I went fishing, and it was with a lovely sister in the church, who because she hooked the bait for me and got the hooked it all up, and here we are fishing, and we caught one or two of those little bitty cutesy little fish that you put in a fish bowl. And, I want to keep it because I'm like, woo, you know, she takes it off the hook and she's like, no, darling, I got to throw it back in. And I'm like, wow, let's keep it. She's like, no, I'm going to throw it back in the water. And that's all we caught was just one or two little of these little bitty fishy things. And I'm thinking, that's okay. I mean, you know, we got snacks. I'm happy. We got snacks. And she says, nope, this is not going to work out. She said, pull up that anchor on that boat. And I'm thinking, me? She says, pull up that anchor on that boat. Y'all, that's a heavy thing. Yo, she says, let's go to another place. So we move the boat and we go to this other place about 15 minutes down on the lake. Y'all, the water's choppy. It's all choppy. Y'all, she throws it in for me and then hands it to me. Boy, we catching fish left and right. They actually jumping out of the water, you know, like those flying fish jumping into the boat. We're catching left and right. I'm going, oh, girl, take this off. I got to throw it back in. Take off the fish. You know, we got bass, those things with the ugly lip. We got bass. We got all that stuff. We're pulling in this fish, and it's tons of fish. She said to me, Andre, sweetheart, if we had stayed where we were, we would never have had the fish we have right now. She said, sometimes you just got to make a change. Sometimes you got to move. You got to get on with it. Stop being okay with a half full cooler. If you want more from God, you got to decide you're ready to make a change. You got to give God your best by trusting God with everything around you. I'm talking about destination. I'm talking about designation. You got to say, hold on up there. This is my prayer time. I'm going to pray every day. If you're still broke, you got to stop spending every dime you have. You got to say, I'm going to do without so that I can get that in the end. Some of y'all have too many credit cards. Cut them up. Ecclesiastes 3, I love it. It says, for everything there's a season. The first 8 verses say there's a time. There's a time to mourn and a time to dance. What time is it, people of God? What time is it in your life? Do you really know what time it is? Regardless of what time it is in your life, you need to make a decision to trust in God, despite what it looks like now. Everything in your life is based on a decision. Choose you this day. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Everything's about a decision. Scripture says, forget those things that are behind you and press on towards the mark. You got to let that stuff go. You got to stop letting it drag you down. You ought to make this your prayer tonight. Make a change. God, make a change in my spiritual life. I want to have an encounter with you like never before. Let me tell you, people of God, when we have an encounter with God, when God shows up in our life in a powerful way, you will never be able to explain it. All you will know is that something bigger than you came down and inhabited you and took over you, and you will never be the same again. You ought to be praying for a visitation from God. You ought to pray, God, make a change in my personal life. Stop defining yourself by your past. Make a change in my personal life. God, make a change in my thought life. Change how you think and what you say to yourself about yourself. I've said it before, but I'll say it again. You already talk to yourself. You might as well say something useful. In the Bible, God didn't say, look at the mountain. God said, speak to the mountain. Tell it to move. You don't look at it. You got to speak it. Make a change in your relationship. If you're in a relationship or even married, stop engaging in behavior you know is distracting, is distancing you from your partner, straining your relationship. Hang on, let me just throw this in the pot while I stand over it and throw things in it. If you're in a relationship, stop aggravating your partner and doing things you know they don't like. If you already know they don't like you doing what you're doing, stop it. Stop aggravating them. Stop making it even worse. You know they don't like it, so why are you doing it? Stop it. Let me keep going. I'll throw another one in the pot. I'll throw another one while I stand over the pot. You cannot have a headache every night of the week. Good relationships have good, and they frequent, and that is what God wants for you. You cannot have a headache every night of the week. You should be. Now, I don't say you have to be a rabbit. For those of you who don't know animals, you put two rabbits together, you'll have 400 in the morning. I'm not saying you have to be a rabbit, but I'm saying if you're in a relationship, God wants you to do it and go at it and love it. Hallelujah. Woo! You ought to do it. Make a change. You want to know why your relationship is dry? Because you ain't doing it. That's why. I got off track. I got to get back. I got to close. It's no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, he will do for you. Y'all remember that old song? You know, you can't keep going the way you're going without making a change. You're headed for a cliff. Some of you, if you don't make a change, if you don't start making some changes now, you are going to lose everything. Listen to me, people of God. If you don't make some changes, some of you are headed towards a cliff. And if you don't start making some changes now, you're going to lose everything. This is for people who say, it's time for me to make a change. I want to say, I'm about to make a change. I'm about to change some things in my life, some people, some relationships, some habits. Today is the day I begin the new me. My season is about change. I'm about to rearrange things in my life because what I desire from God, only God can give me. I can't. Listen, finally, I'm closing. Y'all can come back, the worship team. I can't change your life until I change who you trust. We've got to change who we trust. Chris, you can come on in your shorts. I can't change your life until I change who you trust. We have to turn around and start realizing who we focus on. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. But in all your ways, acknowledge him and he will direct your path. I don't know if you heard that, but that's good. It's a scripture. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. Don't try to figure it out. Sometimes we try to figure God out. Don't. Just let it be. Let God do what God's going to do. Listen, anyone that can hold the earth on its axis and let it do what it's doing, just leave it alone. Just let it go. And lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him. That means get up every morning with your mind set on Jesus. Get up every morning and say, God, if you don't go with me, I'm not going to leave this place. Get up every morning and say, Holy Spirit, come all over me. Dwell inside of me. Angels flap around me. Let me hear the angel wings wherever I go today. God, order my steps. Protect and guide me. Inhabit me. I can't change your life until you change who you trust. Tonight, I want you to change who you trust. And I want you to ask God to give you, help you to make a change. There's a healer in the house tonight. There's a healer in the house tonight. And his name is Jesus. And some of you might have been sitting here tonight listening to me going, make a change, make a change. Yeah, he said it 100 times, make a change. I want to encourage you tonight to make a change. I didn't come to entertain you. I came to challenge you. And I came to encourage you. Some of you go to learn how to encourage yourself. Too many times we don't know how to encourage ourselves. We're too busy dwelling on the past. It was an experience. It doesn't define you. Encourage yourself in the Lord. Encourage yourself. And pray that God will reveal and come down and give you an experience. Let's stand together. Let's run towards God. Would you do that with me? Let's run towards God and say, God, make a change. Help me to make a change.
I'm running to your arms. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough.
Come on, let's sing it one more time. Lift your hands and ask God to reveal. Let's sing it together.
And oh, I'm running to your arms. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever. I'm running to your arms.
I'm running to your arms.
The riches of your love
will always be enough.
Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever.
How to follow that. Thank you so much, Reverend Andre. I was thinking during all of that, because we all want to experience change. We all are embracing the idea that there is something that needs to change. And I love how you ended it with the idea of trust, because I think if we look at the life of Jesus with his disciples, it's a journey of change and transformation and challenge, and they followed him all that way because they trusted him. They trusted what he was going to do. They trusted what he was saying. They trusted that he was sent by God. And so I imagine they experienced a lot of change. And when they got to that upper room that night, we're probably like, oh, thank you. Passover meal, I get it. Passover meal. I've been doing a Passover meal since I was a little kid. Oh, let's go back to what I know. And so he said, yes, that's the meal for now, the meal that you've always had. But he also gave them a picture of the not yet. Yeah. So while they were there in a comfortable meal, he was challenging them to change it, to move forward in a different way, knowing that he would be gone and that he would leave them with the encouragement to change and to challenge and to move forward. And so he took the bread and he told them about the not yet. He gave thanks and he broke it. And he likened it to his own body. All of the things that he had done with his body were now things they were going to do. And he was giving them the nourishment to do it. And then he took the cup and he blessed it, and gave thanks for it, and he poured it out. And he gave them a picture of the not yet. He gave them a picture of who they were in the kingdom, in the presence, in the realm, in the newness of God. And he said, drink, it's for all of you, and be encouraged.
Will you all pray with me? Holy One, thank you for this meal of grape and grain. Make it for us your holy presence in us. Empower us to make the change that you want us to make in ourselves and in this world. We ask for your blessing. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And as the ministers come forward to prepare a place for you, know that you can come forward and partake of communion. You don't have to be a member of this church or any church. You don't even have to have a belief system. Whatever you are on your faith journey, you can come forward and experience the meal that changes and transforms each and every one of us, each and every day. And so you can come forward as the ushers indicate for you to do so. We will dip a wafer and put it on your tongue. If you'd like to dip yourself, you put your hands out. If you just want a blessing, you can go like this. And if you need some extra prayer, we'll have Reverend Andre praying on the side. So come forward, for all is ready. The meal of the not yet is here now for you.
Thank you. his hands and multiply. God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire.
My hope and my prayer for us this evening, as we have heard such inspirational words for us, that we might go out into the world, that we might go home, that we might know right at this very moment the thing or things that we want to change, and that we might be brave enough to look at the man or the woman in the mirror, and that we might see ourselves, the not yet ourselves and know that that self is still in the making, that we'll be willing enough to let some things go in order that we might become what we see, what God sees in the mirror. God bless you this night. Remember there's Pulse Cafe. Remember there's still tickets for the bowl. But most of all, remember that you are a divine loved child of God. Go in peace.